What's up, everybody? Top of the afternoon, Sunday Sessions, episode 14. Here to drop some heat on y'all about growing a successful Amazon business and really making the tweaks necessary to take your Amazon company to the next level. For anybody who's just joining for the first time, my name's Eric Castellano, and I'm the CEO of Amazon Lit, a consulting company that helps people just like you, whether you're just getting started or you're already operating a massive Amazon business, help you grow your business. All right, let's get into this here. How we doing, my friends? I apologize, the people who cut my grass are downstairs cutting my grass. So if you hear a little background noise, that's what it is. Hello. So it's same as always, ask your questions, I answer them. Provide a ton of information, ton of value, help you grow your business. We've been doing this for 8 years selling on Amazon. We average about $4.5 million a month. I'm excited to be here, excited to drop some knowledge on y'all, excited to really help you navigate within Amazon's terms of service to help your business expand to that next level, whether you're doing 4 figures, 5 figures, 6 figures, 7 figures, 8 figures. We've helped businesses at all levels. I got some updates too before we get started here. So we got some events coming up. The most important event for you to put on your calendar is ASD. So ASD is from August 22nd to August 25th. And while we are out there on August 23rd, which is a Monday, we will be hosting an event, Business Growth Hacks Live. It's going to be amazing. We got speakers lined up. We got just tons of information, tons of content we're going to provide to you. I encourage anybody who's interested in selling on Amazon or already sells on Amazon to be in Vegas that week, because it is going to be revolutionary for growing your Amazon business. I promise you that. I guarantee it. It's going to be crazy. Then second thing is August 7th in Miami. If you can't make it to Vegas, you live closer to Miami, you want to go to the Miami event, Miami2021.com. That's an event we will be at as well. We are not hosting it. Avery, Romer the Romer, and Taylor Jones are hosting this event. So that's going to be dope as well. You should come definitely check that out. But I'm telling y'all, Vegas is the place to be. August 22nd to August 25th. We're flying in on the 21st. And we're leaving on the 24th. Those are what you should be considering as well, those dates as well. We got some questions over on the YouTube side. Isaac loves our content. Appreciate you, Isaac. How do we batch our orders from the manufacturers? Some of the items from an order sell out before others. Do you wait for them to sell out and repeat the batch order, or do you do smaller orders? We definitely do smaller orders, because worst case scenario is that your item runs out of stock. So you do not want to wait until you need to reorder all of your products at once, because if you're doing that, then some of your best selling SKUs, your faster selling SKUs, will run out of stock, and that's not good for your BSR. You want to keep that BSR low as possible, and it's not good for your page standing. You want to be on that first page, and if you're on that first page and you run out of stock, you're no longer going to be on that first page, and it's going to be challenging to get back up there. And is there any software that helps you automate the batch order planning? Yeah, so you could use Forecastly, Restock Pro. Those are great forecasting softwares and inventory tracking softwares that can really analyze your current inventory and really help you grow your business and take it to the next level. So let's see, I'm sure we got some questions over here on the Instagram side. How do you recommend setting up merchant fulfilled operation for Q4? So first thing for merchant fulfilled, because there's definitely going to be some sort of restrictions on inventory for Q4, right? Q4 for Amazon sellers is the biggest time of year. Our sales increase by about 25% on average. Our profits increase by about 15%, which is good. That means we're making more money. You're making more money. So you definitely want to have a streamlined production station for your FBM, because those orders are going to be flowing in. So imagine a McDonald's production line where they're producing the Big Mac, right? First you bust out the bun, and then you got the mayonnaise and the ketchup, and then you put the lettuce and the tomato, and then you slap the burger on the sandwich, and then you wrap it or you put it in the little box and slide it down to the conveyor belt to get picked up and processed in the order. You want to replicate that in your FBM production process. You want to do the same thing. because it's going to save you a lot of money on the back end. Something that most people don't think about is the amount of money that they're spending to get the product out the door, right? We call it your PCPA, your production cost per ASIN. Not many companies consider this. I'm yet to meet more than a handful of companies that consider their production cost per ASIN. This is a number that we have down to a science. We understand what it costs us based on what our rent is, what our labor expenses are, what our shipping expenses, what our boxes and our tape and all those supplies are. We have our production cost per ASIN down to an exact number. So when we're analyzing profits and gross revenue, we know that, let's say our average gross revenue or your average gross revenue is $4, but it costs you $1.50 in production costs to get that ASIN out the door, then really your net profits per sale are $2.50, which is still huge, right? Because if you're selling 100,000 orders a year, you're looking at $250,000 in net profits every single year. Now, a company like ours, we're shipping 250,000 orders a month, right? That's a lot of orders. We're shipping about 3 million orders a year. So even worst case scenario, if our net profits were a dollar on every single product we sold, I'm talking net, like after all expenses in our pocket, $1, that's still $3 million in net profits a year. So it's important to understand those numbers, and I encourage you, we have a dope YouTube video. I'll put it right here. And it's a really good YouTube video, and it shows you how to process those numbers and what math is needed to understand those numbers so you can further understand your business and continue to grow. ASD is huge opportunity for all of us looking for suppliers. Absolutely. Do you have any walkthrough showing how we should contact, talk to suppliers in the ASD market? Yeah, so sometime in the next couple days, we're going to be posting all this information. A, you should already be signed up for ASD. So for anybody who doesn't know, ASD is one of the largest wholesale trade shows in the world, right? Companies from all over come to exhibit at this trade show. I've exhibited at this trade show. I've been attending it every year for the past 5 years, sometimes twice a year. And currently to date, we do about $3 million in sales revenue from companies we've met at ASD. So I encourage you all to be there. It's super important. You should invest in your business, invest in the growth of your company, and just book the flight, book the airfare, go out for two or three nights and experience it. We'll be there as well. And Javid's question over on YouTube was, will we have some sort of walkthrough or training for people who've never been to a trade show before and they're not sure how to navigate that trade show? And the answer is absolutely yes. So it's called our trade show walkthrough. We'll be posting about it in the next couple days. And this gives you an opportunity if you're inexperienced, because I know what it's like to be inexperienced at a trade show. I remember my first three or four trade shows. Oh my God. I was just so nervous to walk up to companies. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know who to talk to. I didn't know what to look for. And my first three or four trade shows, like my first one was in Anaheim, second one was in New York City, third one was in Baltimore, fourth one was in Philadelphia. So I invested a lot of money to get to these places. And then like between airfare and food and car rental and hotel and like all this money. And I just walked around completely clueless, you know, and I was like, oh man. So what our goal is for you to never have to do that. We never want you to experience the same uncomfortability we experienced early on. So, you know, we offer a trade show walkthrough where we meet you, you know, at 9 a.m. We spend a few hours walking the floor with you, showing you the ins and outs. And then you also get access to like the necessary things to bring before you go to the trade show to prepare you mentally and what to look at to really get you in the headspace of growing your business. So absolutely, we'll be doing that. Okay, let's get Tex-Mex Picker in.
What up, Eric?
What's up, brother? How you doing, man?
I'm at work in some downtime, man, doing some product research right now.
Nice, man. Nice. You finding some good products or what?
Trying to just going through the process, going through the steps.
Yeah.
And I just saw a notification y'all going live. So
yeah, but
jump in and give a 2 cents.
Yeah. Yeah. So what would you say, right? Because you're, what are you doing monthly right now? Just so everybody kind of get to know. First,
it's dropped a little bit right now. It's probably dropped about, I would say about 5 to 8 a month. I was peaking at like 25,000 a month. So it's dropped a little bit. But I've had some delays just getting stuff out with just, you know, work and life. But
yeah,
getting a bunch of stuff out this week. So it should be coming right back up.
Okay, what would you say if you could give one tip? Because I know just 6-7 months ago, you know, you've since doubled, if not tripled, or even 4x'd your business. So what would you say, one tip to anybody watching right now? Like, what would be that go-to tip for someone who's trying to, you know, grow their business by 10, 20 grand in monthly revenue?
Get on Google and find as many distributors you can possibly find using all kinds of search terms, whether it be wholesaler, distributor, supplier. Like you said in the course, start with local because shipping will kill your profit. Start with local, start in every single category local, and then move out from there. But literally find about 50 to 100, if not 200, just possibilities and just start writing emails, start sending contacts, because you never know who's going to respond, either whether it be right away or, you know, a couple months later.
Yeah.
Contact as many people as possible. Get as many price lists as possible. Don't worry about a website. Don't worry about having an LLC. Don't worry about any of that. Just start contacting people, because at the end of the day, they want you to spend money. That's all there is to it, really.
I love it. So you heard it from Carlos. Carlos said, dive deep into Google, start finding those distributors and reaching out and building those relationships. Carlos, are you heading out to ASD?
You know, we booked it 2 nights ago, the hotel and our flight. We already booked it, so we're ready to go.
With the wife?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's going to be first half of the day business, second half of the day fun.
Good, man. That's good. Definitely go hit a show, you know, get a nice and enjoy yourselves. And the best part is you can write the entire trip off as an expense, you know?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Bring a little bit of play money, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, we're excited, man. I went to the ASD in Dallas, and I'm in Houston, so I went to the fishing show, the Houston fishing and boat show this year. So just in those couple of trade shows, if y'all haven't been to a trade show, man, that's probably one of the best little nuggets you can get from this, is going to trade shows and talking to people.
Yeah.
Right. So just in those two shows, I've learned so much, and I can't wait to get to Vegas to do it out there.
Yeah, 100%. You know, and I think a lot of people, they think when they think trade show, they think of the initial expense to get out there, right? The airfare, the hotel, the food, maybe renting a car. But what they're not thinking about is the future business opportunity. So I encourage anybody who's considering going to any trade show or Vegas at ASD, don't focus on the short term, what money's going to come out. Focus on the long-term potential of your business growth.
Yeah, definitely that. The expenses that I encourage going to the trade show, just, you know, gas and hotels and stuff, it's paid itself back tenfold from the contacts and accounts I've acquired from there.
Absolutely, man. Well, Carlos, man, I know you're at the office getting some things done. I'll see you tomorrow night on our coaching call.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, man, I look forward to it, and I'm excited to see you in Vegas as well.
Yes, sir. Y'all take care.
We're meeting in all the states. We've met in Texas, we're going to Vegas. We got to hit up some more states together, you know?
I got you.
All right, Carlos, man. I'll talk to you.
All right, take care.
So that's Carlos. Carlos has become a good friend of ours. He joined our program, I want to say back in February or March. His business has grown substantially. Yeah, he's a good guy. You know, I met his wife back in Houston a couple weeks ago, so that was cool. You know, we really harvest a great community with Amazon sellers, you know, our e-sellers, our iProgram. The date for the meeting in Vegas is August 23rd, which is a Monday. It's on the evening of August 23rd. JC from YouTube asked, how many hours do you spend at the warehouse a week? It varies. Some weeks I spend 60, other weeks I spend 20. You know, it really depends on what's going on. Thank you for everything you give to everyone to help everyone grow. No problem. What software do you use for keeping inventory, and what software do you use for scanning the items on a shipment? So for inventory, you could use Restock Pro or Forecastly. Those are both great options. For creating shipments, you can use something like Wizard Industries, or you could use Inventory Lab. Those are great options as well. So Shez just said the Dallas ASD show, which was a little different, right? So what ASD did because of COVID is they traveled the country. So they did Dallas, Orlando, and then they did Nashville or something. So you also got to think, they split up the show into three different events. So it was about a third of the size, if not smaller, because this was in the middle of COVID. So a lot of people weren't coming out. A lot of vendors weren't traveling. So, you know, those shows were definitely smaller, but the ASD Vegas event is definitely an event to go to. Rizzo asked, should you avoid Amazon on listings at all costs. No, you shouldn't avoid Amazon on listings at all costs. When there's a few criteria when we avoid Amazon on a listing. The first criteria being if Amazon's the only seller on the listing. If they're the only seller on the listing, we'll avoid them. So you just expand the Keepa chart, look back historical data on Keepa, and you make a decision. The second time we avoid Amazon a listing is if they're consistently in stock, you know, more than 75% of the year, and they're always winning the buy box. So when you hover over that Keepa chart, you see the little red dots that show who is the buy box. If Amazon's always in the buy box and they're dominating the buy box and they're not giving it up to the other third-party sellers, then we will stay away from that listing as well. Now, the exceptions where we will jump on a listing is when you're looking at Keepa and Amazon's listed higher. So you'll see the third-party price will be down here on Keepa, and then the which will be the buy box price normally, and then Amazon will be 2 or 3 or 5 or 10 or 50 cents higher or dollars higher than the sellers in the buy box. So that is a great listing to get on. Also, an Amazon listing that I encourage sellers to get on is one where they're not consistently in stock, and the price when they're out of stock that's on the listing is a price you can make money at. Billy just asked, where will we be meeting at ASD? So we'll be doing a trade show walkthrough on the 22nd, which is a Sunday. We'll be doing a trade show walkthrough. So anybody who participates that will be meeting at the event at ASD at about 9:30. And then on the 23rd, which is the following day, Monday evening, we'll be hosting an event, 7 p.m. it starts. And just keep an eye on our Instagram. We'll be posting about that in the next couple of days. What advice would you give early stages doing RAOA? Buy as many products as you can and just keep sending them into Amazon. Right. And then when you start generating enough money to kind of make the transition into wholesale, I would encourage you transferring 10% of your business to wholesale while you still do 90% RA, and then make it 20-80 and 70-30 and 60-40 and 50-50, because that's what's going to help you grow your business. It's very challenging. Don't get me wrong. You know, our first year doing RA, we did about $1 million in sales, but it's hard to scale when you're just doing RA because it's a lot of busy work. How would you pay employees like shippers and shoppers? Depends. You could pay them cash if they're only working a few hours a week, but if they're working 40 hours a week, you're going to want to set up some sort of payment service through either ADP, and there's some other softwares out there, just to legitimize it, get them on the books, you know, take taxes out and stuff like that, you know. So you definitely want to do that if they're working substantial, consistently 40-hour week. So Joseph just asked, can you explain more about what the eSellers RI program is exactly? We're doing Amazon wholesale, shipping 2 to 4 pallets per week, and want to take our game to the next level. Yeah, so I'll give you a brief synopsis. There's 3 main points to eSellers RI. First is weekly live mentoring calls with Sebastian and myself. Every Monday, we jump on a call. Second is lifetime access to a private Facebook group where you literally can ask your questions. We never want you watching another YouTube video ever again to learn anything, another seller forum, another Google search for all your Amazon needs. We want you to ask them in the Facebook group and we'll answer them rather quickly. The third is step-by-step tutorial training on how to grow your business. Like right now, you said you're sending 2 to 4 pallets per week. We'd like you to be sending 20 to 40 pallets per week. And we'll show you through our experience what we literally do every single day in our business today, what we still do on a daily basis. We'll show you those processes so you can implement them into your company.
If smart sellers are stocked up, then do you know they get buy box? Smart seller equals over 1K feedback.
I don't know where you heard that. But yeah, feedback definitely helps you win the buy box. It definitely adds value there and helps you win the buy box. So 100%, you want to have as much feedback as possible. You know, also, you want to have competitive pricing and you want to have ample supply and you want to sell on a lot of different listings, because that's really where the change in business growth happens. What would be the starting budget for wholesale? I recommend having $2,000 to $4,000 liquid capital to place your first 1 or 2 orders. Let's get Rizzo in. Yo, Rizzo, what's up, man?
Yeah, good, bro. You?
I'm good, man. How about yourself? Everything's good?
So it's basically my first 3 months. So basically, I just want to say, like, how's the best way to go about it with RO and OA? You know, in the beginning stages.
Yeah. So you want to essentially go to as many stores as possible or research as many websites as possible to send in as many different items as you can to make as much money. You know, it's really, it's no different than wholesale. It's a volume game. So the more products get access to at retail stores or online stores, the more money you'll make.
Okay. So the one of the main things that I struggle with is you know, you've got the penny wars. So, you know, I'm listing mine for like decent ROIs, and then, but then like you see so many people that come in and undercut, and that comes frustrating at times.
Yeah. So that happens very frequently, especially if you're buying leads lists. What they're doing is they're sending that lead list to 20 people, and then five of those people share it on the low with another five people. And before you know it, 30 people on that listing, and it just, and the price tanks. So, you know, you have a few options. You could sell it for a lower price, the inventory at a break even or even a profit loss, or you could analyze the seller's inventory and hold off because most likely they'll sell out in a couple weeks and then you could get it.
Yeah. Just to be leads, by the way.
Yeah.
I've had them, mate. They are shocking. Some of the leads you get, you think, really?
Where are you operating out of? You're over in the UK?
Birmingham.
Yeah. You're selling United Kingdom, or where are you selling?
United Kingdom. Just sticking to United Kingdom for now, just because of all shipping costs and everything at the moment. It's just gone crazy. So it's not worth trying to sell in different parts of Europe at the moment. But it's good. It's fun. I mean, obviously, at this stage, it's all just a learning process. You know, I've learned so much. I've made a lot of mistakes. But now the way I'm sort of sourcing online is reverse sourcing. So just look for good brands and stuff like that. And then look for listings that Amazon are not on. And, you know, limited sellers. And that's now I've started to have a little bit success going through that way of doing it.
Yeah.
And of course, retail as well, you know.
Yeah. A healthy mix of both. And really what you're doing now is you're growing revenue, you're gaining experience. But the end goal would be to make a transition into another business model like wholesale or private label. Because don't get me wrong, RA and OA are great initially. But the bigger you grow, the more running around you're going to be doing. The more, you know, placing orders from this retail store.
I suppose with doing that as well, there's a ceiling. And you won't get past that ceiling with OA and RA.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, it's cool. Well, thank you for getting back to me.
Yeah, man. I appreciate you, brother. It's been a pleasure, my friend.
Okay. Cheers, pal.
Thanks for joining the call. So Joseph said, what are your thoughts on buying a surplus of a particular product 3 to 5 months worth when distributors are offering monthly discounts? We are having a hard time balancing this and keeping liquid cash. Yeah, so cash flow is king when it comes to selling on Amazon. If you don't have the cash flow to make purchases like that, then you shouldn't, because you got to think about the inventory turn, the amount of inventory you could purchase with that additional $10,000 or $15,000 over the course of those additional 3 months that you're purchasing the inventory for. You could turn that inventory multiple times and end up making more money. But if you do have the surplus of cash flow, then absolutely we make purchases where we're purchasing 3 to 6 months of inventory. Sometimes what that looks like for us is a full truckload. So it really depends on your situation. But if you could get a great deal on a product and you check the keeper charts and historically it makes sense, then definitely go for that. So do we teach wholesaling at private label? We teach primarily wholesale, but in our training, we go over how to create optimized listings and how to advertise as well. So that really helps with private label, but we do not cover sourcing private label products. But there's a ton of content on the internet on how to do that. How important is the buy box? Very important. And should that always be part of your strategy to meet buy box criteria if it means ROI target? No, well, you definitely want to be buy box competitive, right? If you're purchasing a product and initially before you even buy it, you're looking at the listing and the buy box is lower than a price that you could be profitable at, then that's not a product you should be purchasing, right? Because no money in it. So you definitely want to make sure the products that you're buying, you're profitable when you are buy box competitive. You want to make sure you're able to make money at that buy box price, because once you jump in that buy box, whether it's for 2 hours or 20 hours or 20 minutes, you're going to see your sales increase, because a lot of these shoppers are shopping on cell phones and you just smash add to cart and whoever's in that buy box is getting that sale. What is the minimum ROI we aim for in our first year? So we don't look at ROI, and we encourage you not to look at ROI. And the reason why is, let's say I told you the minimum ROI you should focus on is 50%, right? All right, so you're buying a product that costs $40. So you're making 20 at 50%. That's great. Right? But now let's say you're buying a product at $2. You're only making a dollar on it. So what we encourage you to look at is profit margin for a few reasons. Not only will it help you scale quicker, but at the end of the year, when you're analyzing your company's health, you're not looking at return on investment. You're looking at your profit margins, your gross and your net profit margins. Also, it's a little more realistic number. So exclude ROI, and I'm going to change your question to what profit margin should you be looking for in your first year? And our cutoff in our first year was about 8%. If the product wasn't making at least 8% at the lowest buy box price, then we weren't purchasing it. This gentleman just asked, or woman just asked, if our sales had slowed down in July. So July and August are historically on Amazon the slowest sales months of the year. And it's because people are out of school, they're traveling, going to the beach, going on vacations, barbecuing, canoeing, they're outside enjoying time with their family. But you're going to see at the end of August, September, October, November, December, sales are really going to pick up because life gets back to normal, right? Kids are back in school. People are back at their regular grind. So, and then the holidays, you got Halloween, you got Thanksgiving, you got Christmas and Hanukkah. So you'll really see a pickup in sales. Wholesalers can be faced with Chinese competitors. I meant Black Hat or any other. No, so the wholesalers you're purchasing, when you're doing Amazon wholesale, you're purchasing products in the United States. So you're not competing with any Chinese distributors because it just doesn't make sense for them logistically to get those products to the United States. It's just, you're not buying Chinese products. You're buying American products, like companies like Unilever and Procter & Gamble. So you don't have to deal with all the rigmarole that happens with private label. Inventory under review. A customer claimed they received the wrong model of a product. Amazon is now investigating my listing. My inventory is not available for sale and stranded. What is your advice for situations? So you want to go to your stranded inventory on the right. There's going to be suggestions of what it is. It's either needs qualification, under review, update listing, whatever that says. Then you want to click edit, and it's going to take you through tasks that you can go through in order to get that listing back active. Now, if it's in your account health, you can go to your account health and see that ASIN, and there'll be some tasks there that Amazon suggests you take, whether it's an invoice or pictures of the product, you know, supply chain, whatever it may be. Amazon may be requesting some information. So Amazon has asked for invoices for our products, and we're comfortable submitting those invoices. What we do is redact the pricing, though. Because Amazon is a data collection agency. That's what they do. They collect a ton of data. So what we'll do is redact our pricing, which we'll just take a pen and we'll just cross out our pricing for our product and submit that invoice. I'm selling 700 units per month, and I would like to jump to 3,000 units per month. What is your advice for me? Between I just rented warehouse and appreciate all of your help and advice. Join eSellersRI. That's my advice for you. Send me a DM on Instagram and join our program because we'll help you grow that substantially more than 3,000 units a month with the information we provide. Because the information we provide, it's not theory. It's actual information that we're doing in our business and continuing to grow day over day, week over week, month over month, year over year. Don't have a business license yet. We'll have one. Hard time doing wholesale without one. Absolutely, it's a hard time doing without one. You just need to create an LLC in the state that you live in. It's so simple. Don't hire an agency to do it. We have a video, I'll post it right here on YouTube, that shows you how to register a business. I encourage you to watch that. It should literally take you 20 minutes to go through the process. And, you know, in that same day for most states, and some other states, a couple days later, you have your EIN. Which is the number you need. What is your normal test buy? Do you always test items, or do you sometimes go deep on the first purchase? It depends on the data. If the data is a little iffy and questionable, we'll do a test buy. Our normal test buy is usually 18, 24 units. It also depends on the volume it's moving, but that's like the minimum test buy. Sometimes 12. Usually we don't like to do 12 because it doesn't give a very good indication of how well the product is selling. But if it's profiting high and it's only, you know, the BSR is indicating only sell 20 a month, then yeah, I might purchase 12. But we also do go deep on products on the first purchase if the data makes sense. Well, everyone, I appreciate your time. thank you so much for joining this live. I'll see you hopefully all in ASD. Book your airfare now. It's free to register for ASD. They do not charge to attend the event. You go to ASDonline.com. You just put in your information. When you're selecting what type of business you are, select general merchandise. Do not select Amazon seller or e-commerce, because then on your badge in big letters, it will say Amazon seller. And that's not a great way to open up the door to new relationships. Now, I'm not saying lie to these companies, but you don't want Amazon seller plastered on your badge. You want what we'll say retail buyer if you choose general merchandise when you're selecting what type of business you operate. So we'll see you all in Vegas. Our event's happening on August 23rd. It's going to be a movie. We're going to have multiple speakers coming from all over the country. I encourage you all to be there. It's going to be amazing. We got a speaker who spoke with Zig Ziglar on the Zig Ziglar tour along with his son and did some super motivational thing. He travels, he trains companies like McDonald's and some of these Fortune 500. He trains their sales teams and he's going to be there. We have Vanessa from Full-Time Amazon going to be teaching you all about some account health things and how to properly manage your inventory. She's coming all the way from Miami, and we have some other special bonuses there as well. That's August 23rd in Las Vegas during the week of ASD. We'll see you all there. Have a beautiful rest of your day. Stay grateful and stay lit.